there, everyone, and welcome to episode 12 of the Halfway Through the Heat podcast, the world's most important transatlantic wrestling podcasts, or maybe second most important, if you can name another one, but I don't think you can. So, world's most important. And I'm joined today with my co-host, Tom. Tom, how you doing?
I'm doing great, despite the horrible heat here in the Halfway Through the Heat halfway house. Try saying that three times fast.
I'm glad there's horrible heat there, because usually that's my state, but it's been crazy weather here, so there's like a typhoon going on today. It's kind of crazy. If you hear any rain noises, that's because there's inclement weather.
We're not talking about the wrestler typhoon either, like an actual typhoon.
Yes, an actual typhoon. The wrestler typhoon would have been way better, but he wouldn't be making rain noises unless he's just kind of making shh noises in my ear for some reason.
That might have been his gimmick at one point, if he, you know, well, because he was Fred Ottman, right? He was the Shockmaster.
He was the Shockmaster. You never know. They could have made him into some gimmick like that.
Well, but we're not going to talk about the Shock. We might. I don't know. We're not planning to talk about the Shockmaster this week. We have a lot of stuff to talk about. We're going to talk about whether or not the click is cancerous.
Yeah,
we're going to talk about the cratering of WWE ratings and what that means for wrestling as a whole. We're going to talk about the future of independent wrestling, because WWE just announced a big signing from Japan. We're going to say something positive about Raw, because that's how we start the show. A lot of negativity, a lot of criticism of the Raw brand on the internet, but we're not like those people. We're positive. We're going to say something positive about Raw. This is going to be interesting, because this week you weren't able to watch Raw. Your positivity is going to be at one remove.
It's true. I haven't been able to watch Raw yet, and I've only seen a few clips of things from Raw. So I'm going in completely off my clips, but I've read a recap of Raw also. But yeah, I'm kind of glad I didn't watch Raw.
Let's keep it positive.
Okay. So, positive thing about Raw. I saw a bunch of clips, but probably the... I'm glad to see Sting having fun again. That's always nice. He's back to being kind of the Joker Sting again, minus the Joker makeup, which is nice. Kind of crazy Sting. That's the fun Sting, I think.
Yeah, this is a callback to his insane icon character from TNA.
I think that's good, because, you know, the insane icon thing was kind of good, despite it being, I mean, we've talked about this before, but kind of good despite it being attached to the weird Joker thing.
Yeah, I mean, despite, like, it could have been terrible, but Sting clearly has so much fun doing it, and I think that's what saved the Raw segment. Like, he takes the statue of Seth Rollins. By the way, the fact they made a statue of Seth Rollins is one of my favorite things about Seth Rollins' reign as champion.
What is the statue made of? Is it like a foam statue, or was it?
I don't know. I feel like it's sort of more substantial than that, which is why I think it wasn't actually destroyed in a garbage compactor, and we'll see it again. But my hope was that it was made of chocolate, and Sting the Insane Icon would have eaten it.
That would have been delightful.
That would have been great.
Man. So how about you, positive thing about Raw?
So for me, positive thing about Raw was everything involving the New Day. Like, they are quickly becoming my favorite thing, not just about Raw, but about WWE, to the point where if Raw was like 3 hours of them at band practice, I would watch it.
The New Day is really good. And, man, I only saw like a slight clip of them, like with Edge and Christian in the back. So, I didn't see like all of their wackiness, but yeah, the New Day is really good. And I think that's, I don't know how to explain how good they are, because they're not only are they good wrestlers, but they're such wacky characters that, they're just fun to watch, because you never know what kind of crazy thing is going to happen when they're doing promos and things, or what wacky thing they're going to say. And I think that's a really good thing for the New Day. I hope they don't break up the New Day anytime soon.
No, I agree. I it looks like the New Day are headed for a match of the Dudleys at Night of Champions. I love the New Day. I think everything they're doing is great. It's one of those things, like the New Day gimmick, when you remember when it started, it was so bad. And they've just made lemonade out of lemons and are clearly having the time of their lives. I think that's what makes the Insane Icon thing work so well, too. Like, Sting is just clearly having a blast. And that comes across. In the New Day, they're just clearly loving their ridiculous... Like, whoever decided to give Xavier Woods a trombone deserves a Pulitzer Prize. That is amazing.
I would almost say that it was probably Xavier Woods.
It could be. Yeah, it probably was. Yeah, I can't imagine anyone creative coming up with that. But they had the match. It was them and Rollins against Cena and the Primetime Players. And it's because that's exactly the kind of main event you'd see at a house show. And for that reason, it was just a lot of fun. That's my positive thing about Raw, I guess, the main event. It was like it was a match that didn't really mean anything, didn't really particularly advance any storylines necessarily, except kind of Cena Rollins, but Rollins is more feuding with
Sting
right now. And but it was just a lot of fun to watch. Those guys work really well together. Yeah, I mean, I'd like to see more of that on Raw, honestly, instead of like giving away matches that we're going to see at the pay-per-view. I think it makes more sense to mix it up a little bit.
Makes sense. And I like that the New Day is in the main event.
Yeah, I agree. Absolutely. And I think it's a response to actually what the crowd likes.
Yeah, I mean, good booking then. It makes sense also that they're not giving away a match that would be on the pay-per-view. Like, I think, you know, I've mentioned this before, but like before the last major New Japan pay-per-view, like the people all like the top guys had not lost any matches for 6 months, like all of them. So it was the kind of thing where like, you know, you're going into a match with two guys who haven't lost a match in 6 months. And that's the kind of thing where like you actually don't know who will win that match. You have no idea. It's not easily predictable. It's not like, oh, well, he won the last one, so I guess the other guy's going to win it this time. It's the kind of thing where like everybody has been built up in a legitimate way. So like when you're hitting Wrestle Kingdom, you're like, oh my god, who is going to win this? It's going to be awesome. And they're doing that same kind of thing this year also with like Okada and Tanahashi are going to probably that'll be the match at Wrestle Kingdom for the title. And it's like, it's not like those guys are been losing. And like, Tanahashi won the G1, and like, Okada's the champion. So it's the kind of thing where those guys are being booked super strong. So it's they'll probably not lose any matches until then.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about at least some of the direction. The rest of the show doesn't really fit in with the positive theme of the segment, but so I say, I think they have ways to go before they kind of correct this nosedive they're in.
Yeah, well, I guess that's a good the nosedive they're in is probably a good segue into the news. We can start with that one about the WWE ratings being down.
Yeah, this was interesting. This was actually in Forbes, which is not an outlet that normally writes about the WWE, but this was So ratings are an interesting subject in WWE and sort of an important one for wrestling at large, because for better or for worse, WWE is the highest profile wrestling company in the United States and probably the world, let's be honest. And they're not doing so well in the ratings. So according to the Forbes story, which I think gets a lot of its data from the Wrestling Observer newsletter, in July, this past July, WWE, the Raw show, averaged a 2.66 rating, which translates to about 3.67 million viewers. That's down 15% in viewership from the previous July 2014, when they averaged 4.32 million viewers. And then in July 2013, they were at 4.00 million viewers. July 2012, 3.35. So they're actually doing a little bit better this year than they were in 2012. I'm sorry, no, 4.91, so they're considerably down from 2012. So, I mean, ratings are sort of up and down, but they've been trending down for a while now, and the same is true of SmackDown, which doesn't get quite as many viewers. SmackDown averages about 2.32 million viewers, which is down 8% from July 2014. So, the Forbes take on this is that essentially TV might go away for WWE, which is a really interesting take. I don't know how much credibility that has. But the Forbes argument is that people in the TV industry are seeing wrestling as having as running out of its popularity. The quote from the story is, "Wrestling tends to be a cyclical business." I disagree, but whatever. "Wrestling tends to be a cyclical business, going round and round from lows to highs, but the disturbing plunge in ratings of the WWE's two biggest shows highlights just how much the average fan's interest in pro wrestling, and specifically the WWE, has waned in recent years."
I kind of think that's probably wrong. And I think that, let me explain that. Like, if the ratings are going down, it doesn't necessarily mean that less people are watching. It could be that those people have got the network and they're just like, I don't have to watch it on TV anymore. I can watch it later on the network.
Yeah. I think there's a few factors at play here. First of all, the continued spread of broadband connections helps people stream it, right? If they don't want to watch it on TV or they don't have cable. The second thing is that there are more options for people right now. You know, this is a continuing story of the problem with wrestling. But I'm interested in the idea that if the WWE fails, what does that mean for the rest of the wrestling world? Now, I want to say that I don't think there's much chance the WWE is going to go off the air anytime soon. 3.67 million viewers for Raw is still one of the highest rated shows on cable television in the United States. And USA is probably not going to want to give that up anytime soon. It's by far the highest rated show on the USA Network. But that does suggest is there a problem with attracting new fans or keeping fans? And is the WWE partly to blame? I mean, is the product stagnant? Is the WWE just not giving people a reason to tune in?
It's a good question. I think it's hard to say because a lot of it right now seems to be a kind of, I want to say like a down period, not because there's like a lack of talent, but because there's a lack of notable characters is what I want to say. Like, do you know when you think of, WWE, you and I watch it pretty regularly, so there's, you know, enough, we know enough about it to, you know, recognize people. But if you're just like a casual fan, like who do you gravitate towards at the moment? Like, the only person everybody knows really is people like John Cena.
Right.
And like beyond that, who are their big names that everybody knows? John Cena and.
Right.
Like,
exactly.
I guess you could say Sting, Triple H, but like, it's not like those people are really wrestling that much. Brock Lesnar, maybe.
Yeah, Lesnar. I mean, it was CM Punk until he left. He was one of the guys who legitimately had sort of mainstream notoriety, and then Daniel Bryan was building that. But he, you know, at this point, his injuries may keep him out of wrestling for good.
Yeah,
The question is, the Forbes article makes the argument that this makes the network more important than ever, right? Like, that the WWE may face a point in its existence when it does not have cable television, and that means it would have to put all of its programming on the network, which currently has about 1.1 million subscribers. I don't know if that's the case. I mean, I definitely think that the network is an interesting and innovative solution to every... I mean, ratings for everything are dropping except for professional football in the United States. I mean, we should make that clear. Nobody has ratings like they used to. But has the WWE become so identifiable with wrestling that if the WWE is in trouble, is wrestling in trouble?
Oh, that's a good question. But I think it's not. I mean, if the WWE were to disappear entirely, it's not like wrestling would go away. I mean, obviously the kind of mainstream view of it would be kind of like, oh, there's not a lot of wrestling. But I think it would just kind of go back to another territory system where people like local wrestling would become way, way more popular, you know, because when there wasn't the kind of major wrestling promotion on TV all the time, like you had. You know, you listen to Jim Cornette talk about, like, you know, in Georgia or something. Like they could get 1,500 people to come out to a wrestling show every week.
Right.
And I think...
Yeah, and I don't know if that's, like... Because we're in this position where there's only, like, one major company. It's been this way since 2001. And I don't know if that's changed the landscape to the point where people who used to be wrestling fans and don't like the WWE have moved on to other things. Like, in the past, if you didn't like the WWE, you could watch WCW. Or going back farther, you could watch NWA or AWA or whatever your local, you know, territory was. And now, I don't think a lot of people understand there are alternatives to the WWE. Or maybe, even worse, they think the only alternative is TNA.
Ooh, wow, that would be bad, huh? yeah, that's a good point, too. I think a lot of the problem is that the WWE kind of does overshadow everything. So, you know, but if it were to be gone... I mean, people who like wrestling would still search for wrestling, you'd think. So, I mean, I think they would be more likely to find stuff, even though, I mean, other stuff than the WWE, than they would be if they were just like, well, if I want to watch wrestling, I can just turn on WWE because it's there.
Right. Yeah, it's interesting because you look at, a good example is the United Kingdom, which used to have its own, like, really popular wrestling promotions. And they all kind of collapsed in the 80s, partly because of competition from the WWE and partly just because people were tired of the product. And there's been kind of a revival in the last few years of independent wrestling in the UK, which is good to see. Although I think a lot of it is still sort of oriented toward, it's almost like, you know, plants tilting toward the sun. Like the WWE is still sort of the center of gravity in the wrestling world. And because the WWE is popular in the United Kingdom, people are looking for an alternative, you know, because the WWE only goes over to England once a year. So people want to see wrestling when the WWE is not in town. They're like, oh, there's actually, you know, wrestling happening in London right now or wherever. So, like, if that goes away, do those people still want to see wrestling? I mean, I don't know. It's an interesting question. And I think it's one the WWE has to start to try to sort out. You know, yes, ratings go up and down, but if the overall trend is downward over the last 4 or 5 years... Are they failing to attract new fans? I think in one way, the problem is that the people on the top, Vince, Kevin Dunn, and so forth, have been on the top for so long and have no competition that they're stagnant and they're worried about taking chances. In the past, the WWE always did well when it took chances, and now I think they're risk averse when they should be embracing opportunities to draw in new people.
That is really true. I mean, it's really true about the product and everything. Like, what they're putting out is really safe. I mean, it's safe. There's not really any other way to say it. It's not the same kind of thing like when WWE was worried about WCW. They were, you know, they had to do a lot of stuff. They started getting crazy. They started doing wacky things. They started... I mean, not all of it worked. ICP, for example, they did do things. It's just they didn't actually, they didn't kind of rest back and keep doing the same stuff like they're doing now. I mean, think about Raw. I mean, we were talking about this before we started recording that, like, how many times is Sheamus going to fight Randy Orton?
Right.
Like, it's like Valhalla up in there. That's just like a never ending fight forever. those two are like, you know, it's a good way to look at like the WCW, not WCW, WWE product in that. Freudian slip. Yeah. But the WWE is like totally stagnated because we've seen that thing so many times. And like previously that wouldn't have happened because they would have thrown something in there to spice it up. Mike Tyson would have showed up or something. It would have been something crazy, you know, like something you weren't expecting. And now, like, I don't think there's that kind of need to do that. Nobody feels like, oh, it's really necessary for us to do something crazy or different or just do some, because there's nothing to be different from. There's no,
right.
There's no comparison.
I think that, and we've talked about this, but I think WWE doesn't need to grow its audience. It needs to change its audience, right? It needs to draw people who are affluent and college educated. They don't have a lot of those people in the audience right now. I mean, it hurts to say it, but it's true. They would have to change a lot about the product to start drawing that audience. I think NXT actually could be the way to do it. And I think when you saw that NXT sold out the Barclays Center in Brooklyn, that was an indication of how NXT might be positioned separately from the WWE to draw in a more sophisticated audience. But I don't see any indication of them consciously doing that. I see that right now as sort of like a byproduct of what they're doing with NXT.
Yeah, well, like a lot of the problem with them doing that with NXT is that NXT is like completely tied to the WWE's network.
Right.
Like, if you are not a WWE fan, would you even think like I'm going to get the WWE network to see NXT?
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, you wouldn't. So it's the kind of thing where you don't even have the option to watch NXT if you're not a WWE fan already. So it's not exactly positioned in a way that you can make it, you know, the kind of separate, completely separate thing that can attract new people if they're not watching WWE already. You have like, you know, it's not like a WCW. It's not like a legitimate alternative. It's not like an ECW either, where like they're doing something different that other people like. I mean, they are doing something different that that people like. It's just not completely separate. So you can't just watch NXT without being connected to WWE.
I agree. I think they'd have to, first of all, get it on a cable channel, and second of all, market it in a different way, and then create more of a separate identity where it's not like a farm system where it's its own separate brand, and hope you can start drawing. I mean, because you don't need 4.5 million viewers if you get 1 million or even 700,000 of the right viewers, right? Major League Soccer has a fraction of Raw's audience, but it has a television contract worth many times what the WWE's television contract is worth, because the people who watch Major League Soccer are affluent, and that's who advertisers want. So if you got 1 million people and half those people are college educated and have good jobs, you're already on your way to establishing a niche in television. And I just think the WWE is too frozen in place to think differently like that. I think their solution, when they look around, and we'll talk about this later, I think the solution we're seeing is like, well, we'll just take guys from the indies because, you know, hipsters like the indies. But that's not exactly, especially if you just kind of, you know, take somebody from the indies and turn them into a WWE person, that's not changing anything.
Yeah, I think that's really true, in that the way they're going about it, I can't even say the way they're going about it, because I don't think they're going about it in a way that's like they're consciously doing it. I think it's just there and people are kind of latching onto it, but they don't know what to do with that. And, you know, they're trying. It seems like they're trying to make NXT more of an alternative, but, you know, at the same time, they just kind of raided NXT for all their talent. They just took everybody and put them in the main roster.
Yep.
So it's, you know, it's the same kind of thing where like if they keep doing that, NXT is going to have, they're going to have to keep building NXT stars like all the time. I mean, it's good if you're using it as a farm system. That's great, but it's not going to be good if you're like expecting to have NXT as a totally separate program to bring more people in. And when you look at it that way, what they should do is I'm not saying they shouldn't take guys from NXT and put them in WWE. I'm saying that what they should do is not do it all the time and not do it and just get guys that are never going to be in WWE in NXT. Build people up there and keep them there forever. I mean, build them up as like mainstays. I mean, that's kind of what they're doing with someone like Rhino, I guess, but he's not like really there all the time. And he's kind of recognizable from WWE. But if they took, you know, if they took these new people that they're bringing in, like, you know, a bunch of guys from the indies that probably would flounder in the WWE main roster, and just kind of built them up as like the kind of bosses of NXT, you know, like these kind of dudes that are always in the like upper ranks and kind of around in NXT, it would be better for their, as a brand, I think, of NXT than to just, you know, okay, they're getting over in NXT, let's bring them up. That's
right.
It's kind of like, it's a short-sighted way of running things.
It is, and I don't think it's good for the bottom line over the long haul. It'll be interesting to see. I mean, because I'm sure that WWE knows it has a ratings problem. I don't know what the what they're necessarily doing to right the ship, but it'll be interesting to see if we start to see changes or not. So another interesting news story I wanted to talk about. This is sort of bad for WWE, I guess, although not as bad. Is Bret Hart is really establishing a reputation for himself as the get off my lawn guy of wrestlers right now.
He is like the crankiest of cranky old men. Like every time I see a news article with Bret Hart's name, I'm like, well, what is he crabbing about now?
Like, he's been going back and forth with Hulk Hogan and lately, but he was being interviewed. Yeah, he was like out on some charity thing, and someone was just asking him like his thoughts on WWE stuff. He was like the stroke recovery efforts. He was out promoting that, and then someone brought up the new Click Rules DVD. You know the Click, Triple H, Shawn Michaels, Scott Hall, Kevin Nash, and what's his name?
X-Pac.
Sean Waltman.
X-Pac.
The 1-2-3 Kid. So they asked Bret Hart about. You know, the Click. Oh, hey, there's a new Click DVD out, Brett. What do you think? And this was his response. They were literally a cancer in the dressing room, all of them. it was a cancerous environment in the dressing room with those guys, and they certainly did more negative than positive to the business. Scott Hall, all you have to do is just look at him. He's a train wreck with his own life, and he was a malcontent, or a guy that when you were close to him long enough, you started to feel the same way he did. You just felt so self-destructive and unhappy with your life and your job and everything. Ouch. And it's interesting because
yeah, that's really harsh.
Before the before this podcast, I was actually watching on the network the Greatest Rivals show about Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels, and so Jim Ross is interviewing the two of them, and it's really interesting because like Shawn Michaels is doing his best to be like, you know, like joking and like, hey, you know, it was funny back in the, and like Bret Hart is just like deadpan, just like not having it, not joking around.
Were they both on together?
They were both on together, yeah.
Oh, wow. I mean, because I think... Because Bret Hart hates everybody, and he especially hates Shawn Michaels.
It was delightful. It was awkward. It was awkward. And then when... So he's, you know... So in this interview, Bret Hart is tearing down the Click, and the interviewer says, well, you know, the Click are kind of praised now. And Bret Hart responds, praised by who? Triple H? Ouch.
Yeah, wow. He is like the when I read this too, and I thought like he comes across as the crankiest of cranky old men. Like, yeah. It's really funny. And like I don't know really about, like, you know, because everybody has their own story, but like, you know, generally people tend to think of the Click as not a good group in terms of like wrestling business. In the background, I guess, is what I mean. But
yeah.
But even then, like, I wouldn't come to their defense, but Bret Hart just comes across as so cranky about everything that like you kind of feel like, should I accept this or should I just write it off as Bret Hart being cranky?
Right. Yeah. And you know what? I mean, like, it's not hard for me to believe that those guys, the Click, were not pleasant to be around in the locker room. When he's not the only guy who said those guys were difficult. But at the same time, like, yeah, I mean, he's Bret Hart. Yeah. What kind of interestingly, not on the Click subject, but he's also asked about, there's an Owen Hart DVD coming out. And, Bret Hart, actually says it's going to be garbage because, Owen Hart's widow put so many legal restrictions on what, like, footage could air. Like, so there's nothing from Stampede Wrestling with Owen. There's like no childhood pictures, even the questions. So what he says, his direct quote is, even the interviews, the questions they did with me were so bullshit. He's not blaming WWE. He's blaming Martha Hart for this. So, you know, I guess buyer beware when the Owen Hart DVD, because I was kind of excited about that, but I don't know if it's going to be a weird abbreviated job.
Yeah, it sounded like the way Bret Hart described it. Again, he's cranky though, But it did sound like it wasn't going to be very good, because it sounded like it was going to be just like a really short period, like just his time in WWE.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you're expecting like this full like kind of praising of his career and his life, it's probably not going to happen. I mean, that's the kind of impression I got from the way Bret Hart described it, at least.
It's interesting. I mean, it's always interesting to hear from Bret Hart, because he was one of the best wrestlers who ever lived, but he has become kind of delightfully cranky. And although he's been kind of cranky for a long time.
Yeah, since like, pretty much since he's been out of wrestling.
Right.
Which is like mid-90s. Or late 90s, maybe?
He did, late 90s. He did, however, in the Greatest Rivalries thing, he did say that a match he had with Kevin Nash when they were both in WWE, and Kevin Nash was Diesel, Bret Hart described it as, quote-unquote, one of the best matches of my career. So you and I are on a perpetual search. I'm going to go back and figure out what match he's talking about. You and I are in a perpetual match for a great Kevin Nash match. If Bret Hart says it's... I mean, like, Bret Hart has had some of the best wrestling matches I've ever seen in my life. If Bret Hart says it's a good match, I don't know. Like, maybe it's a good match.
Maybe. I mean, it's a real candidate, I think.
I hope it wasn't, like, at a house show or something. Like, I hope it's, something we can actually find and watch.
Yeah, wow. I will be overjoyed if it really is a good match.
All right, so we're going to keep our eyes open for that. And then some other news, I guess just briefly. Zara Schreiber, who was under contract at NXT but was never actually on television, but she's dating Seth Rollins. She got fired for some very old pre-WWE Instagram pictures that showed like Nazi memorabilia and also a My Little Pony dressed as Hitler, which is a weird kind of... I don't want to know the brony demographic that originates from. So anyway, this week she issued an apology. In lieu of all that's happened with WWE, you know, Hogan and Jessica Havoc, who was apparently like on her way to a WWE contract, and then someone found some old racist tweets or something. Like, does anyone ever come back from a scandal like this?
Yeah, it's a weird question. Does I don't know if they can come back to the WWE. I mean,
yeah.
In this case, like, it seems like anything like that, even if it's been like scrubbed from the internet, is there? It's like a black mark on their history that can't be erased.
Right.
You know, but apparently, like, if you do it, like crimes and things, that's okay.
Like domestic abuse,
whatever, just do your podcast. Like, it's the kind of thing where like lots of stuff like that happens where, you know, people who are on Legends contracts were the Iron Sheik, he got arrested for drugs in the 80s. I mean Jesus, he's probably said more racist things than anybody alive.
Oh man!
If you've ever listened to his anything he's ever said ever,
well, and like I think one of the things too is Michael Hayes.
Oh yeah, Michael Hayes.
So one of the things is don't do it on social media, and then don't do it on tape. Like, so everything that Michael Hayes has been reputed to have said, and he did get disciplined. So there's more than just rumors. Everything he's been reputed to have said, you know, is like a between him and someone else, right? I think it's an odd era we live in when the thing that will do you in is if there's some record of your bad behavior that other people can observe, whether it's an Instagram post that shows your Nazi Hitler My Little Pony fixation, or whether it's a sex tape that gets leaked to the press by Gawker. I'm sorry, did I say that?
No.
Maybe it wasn't by Gawker. Maybe it was an enraged macho maniac who works in the county clerk's office. But yeah, so that seems to be the thing. And like, once people can see it for themselves, like they're much less willing to overlook something. Whereas if like you just hear, oh, Michael Hayes said this, but you're like, oh, well, I don't know. It's odd. I don't quite know how to explain it.
Yeah. It does make me wonder, like, is there any coming back from that? I mean, will we see any of those people ever?
Right. And I think, in fairness, I think, it's hard to compare someone who was never actually on WWE TV with Hulk Hogan. I honestly think, I've said this since the beginning, and I still believe it, Hulk Hogan will be back in a WWE ring before long. I just think he's too big a star. But anyone short of his status, like, even someone who is popular, you know, like, if well, okay, with Jimmy Snuka, that's a bad example because he's been charged with murder. But
also, you know, like, on an update on that, like, the day after we recorded the podcast last week, they scrubbed him from the WWE website.
That's right, and they kind of waited a little while to do it compared to, like, with Hogan, it was, like, instantaneous.
Yeah, Hogan was, it was, like, negative days before the announcement. They, like, scrubbed him before anybody knew what was going on.
Yeah, that's interesting. That's a good point. It's like, before the National Enquirer story even came out, Hogan was just, like, gone. And so that's why there are all those rumors, and people were attributing it to an interview he had done on a radio show years ago. And they're like, oh, that must have been it. But that, of course, was not it. Yeah, the WWE acted really swiftly that time, whereas they waited a couple days before they pulled down Jimmy Snuka's and suspended him from his Legends contract. But if you were like Hacksaw Jim Duggan, who, as far as I know, has never said a racist thing in his life, but if he did, right, he's, you know, he's well known. A lot of nostalgia for Hacksaw Jim Duggan, and he had a great career, although he was kind of a one-joke, one-note career in WWF.
Yes.
Like, does anyone forgive that? I honestly think Hogan is sort of... He's doing his time in I'm Sorry Purgatory now, but I think he'll be back because he's too big a star. But I honestly think this is the kind of thing where, unless you're like Hogan or Austin or The Rock, like that level, this can finish you off pretty quickly because it's always going to be there. Even if you wait like 5 years and you make your comeback, that tweet is just, everyone's just going to bring that up again. Like, you can't get away from it. The way, you know, if it's like a disciplinary notice in your file, like with Michael Hayes, that just disappears in the ether. Nobody remember. I mean, like, nobody actually has it.
Yeah, nobody can see it is the thing. Nobody can reference it directly on the internet or whatever. Man, yeah, I think probably, like, in her apology for the Nazi Instagram posts or whatever, she said, like, you know, she pretty much accepted that her dream of being in the WWE is gone. Like,
right.
There's no coming back. I mean, it's probably true. I mean, there's no way to bounce back from that, especially when you're not a star, which makes me wonder, like, what is going to happen to her? Like, is she going to go to Japan?
Right. That's the thing. Like, cause she wasn't really, I mean, I don't know who she is other than this. I knew she was dating Seth Rollins because weird internet people are obsessed with the Shield and hate anyone who dates the Shield. But it's so, like, Jessica Havoc had her tryout with NXT, it went really well. Then, you know, these evil people, or I don't know, these vengeful people find her racist tweets, and that's the end of her chance with the WWE. But, like, she's still in the indies and, like, was just in the Shine pay-per-view on Friday night, got a big reception. Like, the indie fans don't appear to care, right? And whereas I don't know if that's an option for Zara Schreiber, although I think it's interesting that she is dating the WWE's current world heavyweight champion. Cause, like, and she was with him at some event recently. Oh, at Takeover. Although I think it was before the Instagram stuff blew up. But, like, so at WrestleMania, if Seth is still the champion, is, like, she going to be in the crowd? I mean, like, does she get comped tickets the way that the family members of other wrestlers get comped? I don't know. It's a weird situation for her. And I mean, if she really is like a wrestler, then I imagine she can go and do the indies. But I don't know if that's what she wants. She struck me as more of a, I hate to say this, she struck me as a little bit more of an Eva Marie type.
Makes sense. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of a weird situation. Like, what other, are there any other things you can think of where, like, that would be the absolute end of your career if you said something like that? I mean, for example, like, you had a Nazi My Little Ponies on your Instagram, and what other area of life would that be like a death sentence for you?
Yeah, I mean, I think it all depends on, like, who finds out, right? Because there have been examples of people who, like, post racist stuff on their Facebook page and, like, you know, like teachers, and then it gets out. And then they lose their jobs.
Yeah, but do you think those people are banned, like, not banned, but, like, blacklisted for being a teacher ever again?
Probably not. And, like, I mean, they'd have to go somewhere else.
Yeah, obviously. They'd have to go somewhere else. But it's not like there's somewhere else to go in this case.
No, except the indies, right? And that's an interesting question in of itself. Like, are indie fans like less moral, or are just indies less susceptible to this kind of like whipped up public outrage? Because I mean, you know, not just the Jessica Havoc thing, but like think about Teddy Hart, who was in WWE and had to leave because of personal demons, and he's also been charged with rape. And Teddy Hart wrestles indie dates. I mean, like. So is it just that indies are so desperate for talent and like big names, they'll just overlook it and fans don't give a shit? Like, I don't know. Or just indie fans sort of beyond that kind of manufactured outrage that we see pretty often in public these days.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe indie fans are just dirtbags. Or maybe they're more forgiving than the normal populace who doesn't really care about wrestling. So the kind of thing with that is like, you know, for the most part, when you go see wrestling, you go to see people do something that you can't do, and you go for the story and you go for the kind of interaction that's happening. And
right.
I think it doesn't really matter what the person has done, like in their life for the most part. I mean, obviously you're not going to be like, watching like a serial killer who became a wrestler is probably not going to be probably not going to be popular, but
unless,
like,
that's his gimmick.
Yeah. But okay. Well, but the thing with it is that, like, you know, generally you don't think of like wrestlers as, you know, their normal life person. You think of them as their persona. You know, like when you go to an indie wrestling thing, you don't like think Donovan Dijak is like, hey, like, you know, you don't expect him to come to the ring and do social work or something. You expect him to go and be a jackass and wrestle people. Well, it's not right. Because it's not him. It's not Donovan Dijak, the wrestler, is not Donovan Dijak, the social worker. So
right.
You don't have the there's a bit of disconnect. So when you have somebody, you know, somebody who has, like, again, posted Nazi My Little Pony somewhere, like, you think, well, you know, that's pretty repulsive, but, you know, is that you? Is that your character?
Yeah.
Because I'm here to see your character, and if it's not your character, I don't care. And if it is your character, I just don't like your character.
Right. Yeah, and maybe I'm not supposed to. Maybe you're a heel and I'm supposed to boo you. And, you know, and I think now I'm remembering the sort of the Briscoe brothers. Jay Briscoe got in a lot of trouble. People were so upset because he tweeted some homophobic things. But his explanation was, like, he's like, my character is, I'm like a redneck, you know, like I'm this like backwoods redneck. And this is, you know, so this, and absolutely, like, do you honestly think that most people in Sandy Fork, Delaware are like super LGBT friendly? So that's a really interesting point that you made. I think, you know, that's the kind of the new kayfabe, right? Where does the person end and the wrestler begin? And things like Twitter, which are self-promotion for the wrestlers, like, how much of that is someone being a character on Twitter, and how much of that is them being like, oh no, I'm not a wrestler. I just happen to be a person who tweets and wrestles. Maybe indie fans are actually more sophisticated in that regard because they understand there's a difference between the performer and the person. Like, if you're unhappy with sort of racist attitudes or, you know, Nazi things, you have to like discount lots and lots of, for example, 20th century art and literature.
Yeah, like almost all of it. It's the kind of thing where, like, you know, you have to discount nearly everything because,
yeah, I mean if you think what Hulk Hogan said in that sex tape was bad, let me introduce you to the diaries of T.S. Eliot. Like, you know, like, so does that mean like no one should read The Wasteland again because T.S. Eliot was an anti-Semitic bastard? No. And by the same token, like, do we sort of pretend Hulk Hogan was not the most important wrestler, perhaps of all time, just because he said some dumb things to his mistress? No. It's a separation between, like, as you say, when you go to see a performance, that's what you're there for. You're not there to, like, cheer on people's personal morality. You'd never like any art.
Yeah, you'd never like anything if you had to align your, you know, if everybody had aligned their thoughts with what you think, like,
right.
You'd never find that person. You'd hate everything and everyone. There's, you know, you'd never be able to go see a movie. You'd never be able to go, right. You know, if And like, you know, you'd never be able to listen to music. You'd never be able to do anything because all of that stuff would be kind of tied to this horrible person. Like, you know, there's plenty of musicians who are awful people, but you still like their music. You know, there's plenty of actors who are terrible people, but they, you know, they're good actors. And it's the same kind of thing with wrestling, where it's not, none of these people are real people when they're in the wrestling ring. I mean, they're real people in the sense that they're real, but they're not their real self. They're playing a character.
Right.
So when you're going to see wrestling, who cares really if the person themselves is awful, if their character is good? It's the kind of thing where like there's a separation there. Like, I don't, you know, with the Hulk Hogan thing, it's like, you know, are people so upset because they thought Hulk Hogan was really Hulk Hogan? Like Terry Bollea was actually Hulk Hogan in real life. Like he really was the prayers and the vitamins guy, because like, I mean, it's been pretty like common knowledge on the internet, at least, that, you know, he's like into all these like bizarre sex practices and things. Like, it's not like it's not like he's the golden boy that everybody like imagined he was. So, you know, him like, you know, saying racist things in a sex tape, by the way, is not exactly a shock surprise thing. Like, you know, Southern man in his mid 60s says something racist, like, wow, shock surprise there. It's the kind of thing where, you know, you just, people I think that are really offended by this kind of thing are the people who have trouble differentiating the character and the person.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And I think maybe indie fans like just don't have that trouble. Like, they get that they're going to see Jessica Havoc, the wrestler, not whoever she is in real life. Like, no one's paying to see her tweet. They're paying to see her wrestle. And I mean, it's, you know, like it's a very sort of, I don't know, childish mentality to think that, you know, everybody has to be sort of good and on the level. It's kind of puritanical in a weird way. You know, this idea that everybody has to adhere to these moral standards, and if they don't, then whatever they create is also worthless, which I mean, I think is such a naive view and doesn't understand like all of art.
Yeah, it's a very shallow view of pretty much anything. And it's also a very kind of insular view, in that you're not willing to hear what other people say if it doesn't agree with you. It's a kind of automatic, like, if it's not what I believe, censor that shit. And I think that, I mean, and it, I don't want to come across as defending racist tweets, because I don't agree with that. It's not something I would do, and it's not something I agree with at all. But it's also not the kind of thing that like someone should be destroyed for. You know what I mean? Like, it's not the kind of thing. I mean, obviously there should be some repercussions because it's not really acceptable behavior. But is it like destroying someone's life levels of bad? Because I wouldn't say that. And I think if someone did, I mean, even in my own case, like if you held me to things I said 10 years ago,
oh God,
like,
yeah.
I, you know, I would hate me 10 years ago. It's not even like the same kind of thing, you know. You know, it's like,
and not for racism or anything, but just because like you grow and you mature as you get older. And when you're young and callow, you say stupid shit.
Yeah. I mean, even not even like when you're young, like 10 years ago, in Hulk Hogan's case, like 10 years ago, he's still in his 50s. But it's the kind of thing where like, even a 50-year-old man in a 10-year period can grow as a person. I mean, yeah. I think giving, you know, it's one thing if someone doesn't grow as a person, like that stuff comes out and everyone is like, yeah, he does that all the time still. Then you're just like, fuck that guy. He's not, he hasn't learned a lesson. But like, you know, in many cases, all of these things were things that happened years ago and weren't like things that happened all the time. It was like a one-off thing that happened, many years ago. Like, it's, you know, I have a hard time, like, you know, I don't have a hard time saying, yeah, that's shitty, but I have a hard time saying like that person is exactly the same as they were 10 years ago.
Yeah, and I also think, too, that there are other pieces, especially in Hulk Hogan's case, there's plenty of other pieces of data to evaluate. Like, I mean, this is a guy who's worked in an industry with, people of all races for, I don't know, the past, 30-plus years. And so a lot of the people who worked with him would say things like, oh, he was never like that around me.
Yeah, right? even Bret Hart, who has been, like, in a cranky battle with Hulk Hogan online, has said, like, yeah, I never heard him say anything racist either.
Right.
And, like, he would be the first person because he's, like, taking all these, like, weird cheap shots at him.
Right. Yeah, and I think when you have that, the impulse is for people to dismiss all of that and say, oh no, 30 plus years of doing the right thing, that's all fake. Well, the real thing is this one moment on a sex tape. I have a lot of problems with that attitude, and I have a lot of problems with this sort of this idea that these kinds of kind of personal insignificant transgressions somehow outstrip the very large institutional problems. Like, on the blog, closetofanxiety.tumblr.com, I posted about this, like, good, Zara Schreiber's been fired from the WWE, there's no more racist, and I just posted a picture of Vince McMahon. Because think, like, if you have a problem with racism in the WWE, that's where it starts.
Wow, if you want to go back in time and pull racist things out from people, geez. Vince McMahon, there. It's not Hulk Hogan who came up with all of those crazy racist gimmicks.
Yeah, it's not Zara Schreiber, who decided that the Junkyard Dog was going to be a comedy act. It's I don't think it's as simple as some critics of the WWE would have it, but I do think that the race problem at WWE goes beyond somebody's tweets or Instagram pictures with Nazi memorabilia in the background. All right. This has been a very philosophical episode.
It has. It's kind of a, it's a little bit off topic even, because even though we've tied it to wrestling, it applies to so many other things.
It's true. It's going to get more philosophical still, but at first it's going to get less philosophical, as I want to just mention two things briefly. One is, this is a news item I didn't actually put on our outline, but it just occurred to me, and I mentioned it on the blog. There's this controversy that Phoenix, the wrestler from AAA in Mexico, he was at King of Trios, the big Chikara annual event over the weekend.
Oh, I saw this.
And so the story is that he cut a promo and he said the word fuck, and Chikara is G-rated, it's family friendly, and that Mike Quackenbush, the man who runs Chikara and former indie wrestling great, just apparently lost his shit and told Phoenix he couldn't sell his merchandise. And kind of kicked him out. And then the next night, the last night of King of Trios, Phoenix came back and asked, for forgiveness or whatever. So, I haven't really been able to confirm this happened, although I've seen reports from people who were there who seem to suggest it did happen. And B, I can't, because this is wrestling, I don't know if it's a work, right? So, the whole thing could have been planned from the start. This could be the Easton, Pennsylvania screw job. Right?
Yeah.
Who knows? Maybe this is some angle and Quackenbush is turning heel. I don't know. But as I was sifting through message boards and tweets and things, trying to figure out if Phoenix had actually said the word fuck at a Chikara event and been disciplined for it, it occurred to me that I was being the nerdiest detective ever. Just I should have donned a fedora hat. This is the most pointless and stupid. So I don't actually know what happened at King of Trios. But if Phoenix said the word fuck, then just like Zara Schreiber, he should be banished into outer darkness forever. You don't say swear words in front of the Chikara faithful.
Yeah. I read a bunch of tweets about that, and people were saying that fans were getting kicked out too for making a chance with swears in it that day. So I guess Phoenix said it, and then Mike Quackenbush freaked out, and then the fans in protest were making swear filled chants, and they were getting thrown out.
Oh wow.
So I guess it's probably a little bit on the real side.
That would be a bigger deal if you're kicking out fans.
Yeah,
that's a bigger deal.
So possibly it's something that really happened.
Have the human vegan cupcakes of Chikara turned on their master?
Maybe so. It's could be something. The fedoras have been tipped in the opposite direction, my friends.
It's so funny that this is a big deal, because when you think about ECW or something, or like, you know, like, you know, even indie shows that are not particularly outrageous in their content, there's always like a, you know, fuck them up, so and so fuck them up chant.
Oh yeah, that's true. I wonder how Sakara has managed to get through an entire wrestling promotion without having that chant started.
Having been to a few Chikara events, it's a distinctive wrestling crowd. It's not the kind, it's like a Chikara crowd. It's not, you know, when you go to like indie shows, there's like an indie crowd and you can see this. Sometimes you see the same people from show to show. Like Chikara is a Chikara crowd. I mean, it's very distinctive. It's a very, I mean, the atmosphere is brony-like. I'm not going to lie to you. But they also have like these wrestlers who are in like CZW and stuff and who like, it's so weird that they'll work these like really kind of like nasty shows and they'll be in Chikara where like, you know, everybody's like hugging and pretending to be ice cream cones or something. It's weird. And like Phoenix had never, I guess he had never worked in Chikara before. And so he doesn't know. He's, you know, he's also like AAA. Like he just comes out and he's, you know, I don't, I just, I'm going to start a free Phoenix hashtag and hope that it, gets Mike Quackenbush to block me on Twitter. All right, so that, and then I think that's it for, no. Our last news item. This is a long news segment. That's all we had was news this week, really.
Yeah, pretty much.
So what's the deal with TNA? It's September, and you recall that September was the month we had heard that Destination America was going to make a decision about whether or not it was going to continue TNA. No one has heard anything, right? So they haven't, now correct me if I'm wrong, but they haven't announced any TV tapings for October, but there also hasn't been an announcement that they're being dropped, right?
Yeah, that's the thing. Nobody knows, but they also haven't, they haven't actually said there's any TV tapings, but apparently like everybody is in the dark, like including the wrestlers. So who knows what's going to happen? There was a thing recently where I think some of the international shows were canceled.
Okay.
If I'm remembering this correctly, but beyond that, I haven't really heard anything about it, like nothing about it, them in the U.S. at least. So who knows what's going to happen there? The TNA death clock is 2 minutes to midnight is all I got to say. It's, you know, we're edging ever closer to the TNA apocalypse. It's pretty close.
We really need to make a TNA death clock.
We really do. But there's probably a novelty Joker Sting wall clock or something that we can just inch forward. Find that on eBay, Tom.
So I could probably do that. So TNA has a Bound for Glory. The pay-per-view is scheduled, right? But there's no TV taping. So it's this weird. Also, I just see this is new. Breaking news reported by Bill Pritchard at WrestleZone. Kurt Angle told Mark Madden, you remember Mark Madden from WCW, the bad years.
Oh yeah, Mark Madden. If you don't remember Mark Madden, just remember he was the fat guy in Hawaiian shirts who did commentary towards the end of WCW.
He gets into these Twitter feuds with the Young Bucks where he's like, it's just brutal. It's like it's watching like a guy. It's like watching a no-legged man in an ass-kicking contest. Like, he just has no idea what... Like, they just... Their verbal dexterity is so far beyond his. Like, he just kind of ends up, like, tweeting these insults. Like, yeah, well, you're Marks. Oh, good one, Mark. Anyway, so Kurt Angle was on his show today and says that he will not resign with TNA when his contract is up in January.
Wow. No more Kurt Angle. Who are they going to put the title on?
I think you and I both know the answer to that. Slap nuts.
Oh no. No, there's not going to be a title. Who are we kidding?
Yeah. Who are we kidding? So that's interesting. So I guess that moves the death clock like 1.5 minutes to midnight.
Wow. We're like 1 minute and 30 seconds from midnight for the TNA death clock. Oh man. But yeah, come to think of it, there hasn't been a lot of TNA news recently. I haven't seen very much about anything. And I think because there's nothing happening, there's been no TV tapings. There's been none of the wrestlers seem to know what's going on.
Right.
It's
and unlike in the past, you don't have the steady stream of like batshit press releases from TNA saying like we're very close to a huge announcement about TNA's future. There's been none of that.
Yeah, that's probably more worrying than anything. It's do you think that TNA would go back to that their initial way of running things where it was just like a weekly pay-per-view?
I don't know. That didn't seem to work very well for them, did it?
I don't know if it worked at all, but they did it for a while though, didn't they? It was
a couple years.
Yeah, it was years of that. So it must have been working enough to at least cover the costs, unless they were just bleeding money like every year, but it seems unlikely, right?
It does. Meanwhile, Global Force continues to have live dates and TV tapings, although they don't have a TV show.
Yeah, weird.
They have a TV show. It's called Amped, but they don't have like any network or anything. So they're just stockpiling TV shows for at some undetermined point in the future.
I like to hope that they're gonna record like 2 years of TV and then just stop, and just get like a TV deal some way down the line, and just be like this old wrestling from 2 years ago.
That's right. Yeah, the wrestlers have retired. Yeah, so that's a weird. So the TNA death clock is at 1.5 minutes to midnight, 11:58 and 30 seconds.
Yeah.
There's a pay-per-view scheduled, but that's it. That's the only thing we know for sure.
When is the pay-per-view?
I think it's next month. Let me double check that. TNA Bound for Glory. Cause like, you know, the pay-per-view is probably done in advance with, the pay-per-view company. So like you kind of have to do those. I don't think you can get out of that. Oh, October 4th, 2015 at the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina. I've seen it listed online as Charlotte, North Carolina. As a former Tar Heel, I can tell you that Concord is not Charlotte, North Carolina.
Yeah. That'll be... it just makes me wonder who is going to go. What is the storyline? Is there a storyline?
There are... currently two matches listed for it. Ethan Carter 3 versus Drew Galloway with Jeff Hardy as a special guest referee and Bobby Roode versus
right.
Lashley.
They're doing that kind of feud now.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what... I mean, I guess, like, what is going to happen to the Hardys? Are they going to show up like Edge and Christian?
I don't know. I mean, you know, I'm going to see the Hardys in October at an indie show. Like, they're definitely taking indie dates, so I have no idea what their status is in TNA.
I think everybody in TNA is taking indie dates, though, because TNA doesn't have enough shows to warrant...
Not Kurt Angle.
Well, Kurt Angle is Kurt Angle. He probably actually gets paid unlike other people, because, like, he's their biggest star, really.
Pretty much. I also want to point out that the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina... has a capacity of 5,000.
That's like a third of the NXT audience.
It's like it. That's smaller than the pay-per-views that ECW was running in its last year. Like it's shocking how small TNA has gotten. Not that they were ever particularly huge, but like they're essentially just this weird, well-financed indie at this point.
Yeah, pretty much. Oh, the only other news I can think of is. That fan jumping the barricade.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So every member of the Shield has had a fan attack them or jump the barricade to try to join them or something. It was scary with Roman Reigns. He got hit in the head with a replica Money in the Bank briefcase. Somebody jumped after Dean Ambrose and had a knife, but was tackled way before he got to Ambrose. And then on Raw, Seth Rollins is making his way to the ring and some idiot fan jumps out. First of all, what are you doing? Second of all, why is it the members? And I think I know the answer because there's weird sex people who are obsessed with the Shield. Is that the reason it's members of the Shield? I don't know. But I suspect it is.
Yeah, that's really weird. It's weird that it's always members of the Shield. Like,
yes.
Why not anybody else? Why only members of the Shield? Why is there weird sex fiction about members of the Shield? What is it about the Shield?
Seriously, I don't understand. I mean, they're good looking guys. Don't get me wrong. But I don't. Also, this is one of those things, like, I'm not one of those people who sort of yearns for the days of the territories very often, but this is one of those things when I kind of do, like, man, in those days, there was, you know, so as a fan, you're permitted to do all, like, you boo and yell, flip people off, you know, be as abusive as you want. But as soon as you came over the barricade, like, the kayfabe was done, and the heel and the babyface were going to beat the crap out of you.
Yeah, that's like, looking at the video of the fan jumping over the barricade, he looks like a, he looks like a, like a 1990s Rasta guy or something.
He really, yeah, he looks like he tumbled out of a Cross Colors ad.
Yeah, and then like Seth Rollins is just looking at him like, what? Who are right. you?
Because it's live TV, and he couldn't do what they would do, have done in like Gulf Coast Championship Wrestling, which is beat the guy to an inch of his life.
Yeah, that's there's so many stories about that. If you like listen to any of like the kind of like wrestlers in the 80s, like they all have a story about smashing fans who jumped in the ring for whatever reason.
Because why would you do that?
Yeah, it's...
although we talked about too, like it would get like it, Bobby Heenan, some guy shot at Bobby Heenan in Chicago in the 70s at an AWA show. Like it's just, I don't understand.
Yeah, yeah.
But you know, we're in a post kayfabe era, folks. Why are people trying to attack members of the Shield as if it was like 1971?
I don't know. It's really weird though. The Shield's got weird stuff going on around those guys.
They do. I'm really troubled by it. But so, all right. I mean, obviously, don't jump and try to be members of the Shield, whatever you're trying to do. Just stick to your sex fiction about the Shield. All right. So that's a lot of news and philosophy. And so we're not going to we went pretty long last week. So we're not going to go very long this time. But before we go, we kind of want to talk about, we want to consider, what does it mean that the WWE seems to be on a bit of a mini signing spree for international and independent talent? Consider the evidence. One, this, I think it was today actually, Triple H announced via tweet that they had officially signed the Japanese women's wrestler Kana. That's K-A-N-A, not to be confused with the Japanese women's wrestler Kana, K-A-N-N-A. Kana, signed at NXT, will I guess report next month. Kana has had a long and illustrious career in Japanese wrestling, and is a really interesting person in her own right. She is, among other things, a video games journalist and was a graphic designer for Nintendo before becoming a wrestler. And she's sort of a master or mistress, as the case may be, of Japanese strong style wrestling, kind of a famously stiff and impressive wrestler. Won all kind of accolades, performed in all kinds of Japanese promotions and U.S. promotions like Shimmer and Chikara, where hopefully she did not utter any swear words.
Hopefully not. At least not in English.
Not in English. Yeah, who knows? Yeah, exactly. You can say whatever you want in Japanese. So Kana is official. Biff Busick and Rich Swann are basically official. Nobody's announced anything, but they've like hinted at it on Twitter. And I'm going to see Beyond Wrestling the 26th of this month. And like they're advertising on the poster that these are Biff Busick's last matches for Beyond Wrestling. Like, he's going to WWE and Rich Swann, or to NXT, I should say. And then, on the NXT program last week, who should appear, introduced by William Regal, but Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa, who, of course, are young stars of the U.S. independent scene, and they're going to be competing in this Dusty Rhodes Memorial Tag Team Classic thing. Ciampa, who's sort of become famous for his work in Ring of Honor and Pro Wrestling Guerrilla, and Gargano, who is wrestled all over the place, AIW, many promotions. I've seen him at Beyond Wrestling. He's also under contract to Evolve Wrestling right now, which is, when William Regal was introducing them and said they were the hottest free agents in wrestling, I wonder if like Gabe Sapolsky like shot out his TV or something, because Gargano is still, as far as I know, he's still under contract to Evolve. So that's I mean, five pretty high profile international / independent wrestlers coming aboard the WWE mothership in one form or another. Is this good for independent wrestling? Is it bad for independent wrestling? Is this a sign that WWE realizes it has to change its product to attract new people? I mean, what is going on? Because if you remember, not that long ago, Triple H was talking about how the Performance Center meant they were never going to have to take indie talent again. They were going to create their own stars from the ground up And they, you know, he talked about how we don't want people with, and I like Triple H. I think he's done a great job at NXT, but this is an interview with David Shoemaker, I recall vividly. He said, like, we don't want people with bad indie habits. You know, from now on, everyone's going to come through the WWE pipeline. That is obviously not the game plan anymore.
It does. It seems like a bad game plan anyway in the first place. It's like, let's get guys that have no experience.
Right. And like, they have some of those people. And I mean, Dana Brooke is one of those people. And Baron Corbin is one of those people. And Mojo Rawley is one of those people. And they're not working out. Whereas, you know, I don't know, a certain Mr. Seth Rollins, a certain Mr. Dean Ambrose, Kevin Owens. I mean, these are all people who have made big splashes recently and who came up through the, to say nothing of like CM Punk and Daniel Bryan, obviously, who came up through the indies. Even John Cena started out in the indies before WWE.
It's true.
I mean, obviously they've changed course. Does this mean like, the fear that I have seen some people expressing online is that this is like, this is a prelude to what happened in the 80s when the WWF went on kind of a signing spree and signed a lot of guys away from territories. Like, is that what we're witnessing now? Is WWE going to be like talent raiding the indies and we're going to be, you know, going to see Johnny Cockstrong wrestle Dick Justice or something instead of seeing, you know, Drew Gulak wrestle Timothy Thatcher? What's going on?
I think it's not possible for WWE to raid the indies in the same way. Because they took a lot of good people, but there's a lot of good people left.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's like so many good people that like, it's not the same level as, I mean, the level is totally different from the 80s to now. Like when you had those kind of, when you had the territories being raided, like you had like three or four top guys in the territory. And if you took away those guys, you just kind of had a bunch of people nobody cared about. Whereas like right now on indie shows, like it's not exactly like that because they're not a territory. First off, like those people come from all over the place. So you don't really have the same worry that like, oh my God, if Biff Busick and Rich Swann are gone, we're not going to have anybody left to come to our indie show, you know, because right, you've got so much wrestling and you've got like people who are on TV for other promotions that'll still do indie shows like Donovan Dijak, who we mentioned earlier. And, he's like virtually anybody who's in TNA or,
right,
you know, probably tons of Ring of Honor guys.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when I go to indie shows, I see a ton of people from Ring of Honor. I see Donovan Dijak. I see Matt Taven and Michael Bennett. I see Warbeard Hansen. I mean, there are a lot of guys from Ring of Honor who do indie shows. You know, honestly, I know people are sort of wailing and gnashing their teeth because they're A, worried that there's going to be this like massive talent drain, and B, you know, they're worried that these guys won't be used well in WWE. I can't speak to that. I have no idea. I think it's sort of WWE has a mixed success rate with indie stars. I mean, you have your Seth Rollins and your Dean Ambrose and your Kevin Owens and your Sami Zayn, but then you also have like
Bo Dallas.
Solomon Crow, who was of course Sammy Callahan in CZW, who has just been like stranded with nothing in NXT. And Aaron Neville, he's a tremendous wrestler. Also a beautiful singer. Adrian Neville, who I think has sort of been kind of, I think him and Sami Zayn are kind of like in the middle. Like, it's not clear yet whether their success is because I don't think, Sami Zayn because he was injured, but Adrian Neville, I'm not sure the company knows how to use him in the best way possible. He's this crazy high flyer who did really well, like in Japan and in the indies. And they're like, they don't know what to do with him. Kind of the way they didn't know what to do with like Trent Beretta or Matt Sydal.
Make me think that he he's gonna go the same way as like Matt Sydal or something, like, because I mean, you know, looking at those two guys like Neville and Matt Sydal, like Matt Sydal's like I don't want to say more of a high flyer, but like he does more high flying like than Neville does, in the sense that he he does it more in a match than Neville does. And Neville does it, like, you know, a couple times where Matt Sydal is, like, doing standing shooting star presses and stuff.
Right.
And as far as looks go, Matt Sydal is a better looking guy. You know what
He's
I mean?
He's a better looking guy. That is true.
Because Neville kind of looks like a little troll or something. It's really, and he's a great wrestler, but he's very similar to Matt Sydal. And, like, if they couldn't find something to do with Matt Sydal, who is, like, probably more sellable, I can't imagine they'll have anything to do in, like, the long term for Neville. Like, what are they gonna, unless they start bringing back people like Matt Sydal to wrestle against him?
Right. Yeah. And I mean, so that part I totally understand the worry. Like, I like Biff Busick a lot. I like Rich Swann. I like Johnny Gargano. Johnny Gargano is a short dude, right? And that's, like, on TV, that's a problem. And I don't know, you know, and he's like a submission specialist. Like, I'm not sure what they're going to have for him. However, I think in NXT, all these guys could be great. Although it's not, they're not guaranteed to be great, i.e. Solomon Crow. But I think it's actually good for the indies, because for a long time, people in the indies just assumed, like, the best they could do was, you know, getting a regular slot at PWG and maybe going to Japan. Now, I think the fact that this seems more realistic for guys who work a different style, who have a different body type. I mean, nobody ever thought Kevin Owens would be a big star in WWE. So I think it's sort of good for people on the independent scene to realize, like, hey, this is actually, like, a viable option. And this is something I could do. NXT is really kind of open doors that were closed before. And I think that can't hurt. I think it makes everybody sort of raise their game a little bit and kind of not settle for just being a big fish in a small pond. And it also will maybe attract more people to the indies, thinking, like, this is how I work my way up. You know, for a while, I've wondered, like, why are people getting into wrestling, right? Totally made sense in the 90s, especially the late 90s, because you thought, like, if you were, like, a kind of an ex-football player, like Goldberg, you're like, I can make a lot of money doing this. And then for a while, I wondered, like, if you clearly weren't going to be a WWE person, I mean, why would you do it? Now, I think there's sort of an answer for that, because, like, maybe, like Biff Busick, you'll get a shot at NXT, and then who knows where things go from there.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. There is a bit more to do now, as opposed to, like, the past almost decade, where there was pretty much no other option besides WWE and, I guess, TNA, but not really.
Not really.
So it's the kind of thing where, and I guess there is a bit more opportunity to do things with NXT there, and I think that's good. And I think, like, you know, I think someone like Rich Swann or something could probably be one of those people who doesn't leave NXT.
Yeah,
like he would be a good fit. Like, he would be the kind of guy that you'd keep there and, like, teach people how to wrestle. You know what I mean? Like,
absolutely,
have good matches with this guy because he's a good wrestler, and you can, like, learn some stuff. And then when, you know, maybe you have a better look, or you're you know, a bigger dude or whatever, you can get into WWE. But, you know, on the help of someone like Rich Swann, who probably would look a little awkward or out of place in actual WWE TV.
Yep, absolutely.
So, I mean, if they're thinking that way, it's probably a good thought process. But if they were just, you know, I don't know what's actually going on, but if it's that, thumbs up. But if it's not,
right.
There's probably not going to be a bright NXT future for someone like Rich Swann, and definitely not a bright WWE future.
No, and it's sort of interesting. It's also interesting to see the international talent they're bringing in, right? Like, Kana is an interesting choice. Hideo Itami is an interesting choice, or Kenta, as he was in the past. And I'm really curious to see what kind of role. Because Liger has signed some kind of, like, weird limited contract with them. I have no idea what that's going to entail.
Yeah, it's interesting. But I think there is something, you know, like, Kana is a good choice because she's kind of a character.
Yep.
And then, you know, Liger is the same way. So it's like someone who can get over by being a character as opposed to like having to do promos because probably they're not so hot at English.
Right. Yeah. And Finn Balor too was, to all intents and purposes, basically an acquisition from Japan because that's where he had made his fame for spending 9 years in New Japan. But they're all sort of established, like they're all in their early 30s. It's interesting they're going for like the people who've really kind of they're sort of at the peak of their career, and they're not kind of looking to build people up. I mean, I think Rich Swann is much younger, and Johnny Gargano and Tommaso Ciampa, the American guys they're looking for are young, looking in their 20s. But so far, the international talent they've signed have all been like, I mean, Liger obviously is like, I don't know how old he
He's like in his 50s, I think. He's like
is.
50
He's been wrestling
something.
forever. But like, you know, so I'm not sure if there's a deliberate strategy there or what. But basically, I hope it means that we're going to see Shinsuke Nakamura in WWE.
That would be it's probably not going to happen, but
It's probably not going to happen.
it would seem like
Like,
you know, if they were going to sign somebody, it would probably be him because he's a character.
right. He would get, I mean, I think he'd be popular with American audiences in the same way that Tajiri was popular. Like, he's a character who doesn't need to speak to get across to people.
Yeah, I mean he's good at doing that. Like he's good at getting over without having to like do a promo. He can go out and do his like little limbo thing that he does
Yeah.
and yell. And I think people would like it. I mean people do like it. That's why he's so popular. You know, he come out in his Michael Jackson ninja outfit and you know, that's what he does. I think that's a lot to do with why he's over. And I mean, he's not a young guy either. He's like
No, he's
same
not.
age as us. So like mid to late 30s.
Yeah, it would be interesting to see him. I think he could work, but I have no, I mean, like, I'm sure he's making plenty of money in New Japan and maybe does not want to like relocate to Florida.
Yeah. He is like the top guy, one of the top guys in New Japan. It's the same. Like if they were going to take any of the top guys, like that would be the choice, I'd think. You know, are they going to take Okada? Probably not, though. He was in TNA.
That's right. He was backstage at SummerSlam.
Yeah, but he doesn't seem like. I mean, he's a good choice. He would be a good choice, but like, because he's a good wrestler. But like, I don't know how well he would do. And then you know, they're definitely not going to take Tanahashi. I mean, he looks most like a WWE wrestler because he's kind of big and like
Yep.
bulky and you know, he's got long flowing Asian guy hair.
Right, yeah.
He's the most popular wrestler for women in Japan for some reason. But he would be the worst choice because like he doesn't do anything like incredibly special that would get him over, and I assume he can't speak English.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think of the three top guys or the three top Japanese guys in New Japan, Nakamura makes the most sense to me. Okada kind of second. I mean, because he does have that sort of like rainmaker character that could get over here.
Yeah, the Rainmaker thing is awesome because like if you get people throwing the money, it's fun. Everybody likes doing that. But man, I doubt they would take him, but Nakamura makes sense. AJ Styles makes sense. I mean, if we're talking about top people in
Yeah, oh,
New
absolutely. I mean,
Japan.
I don't know. I mean, I would have said, even 6 months ago, I would have said no way for AJ Styles, but you know, you turn on NXT and there's freaking Tommaso Ciampa, and you look at Twitter and there's Triple H saying we signed Kana, who's like got the weird like face paint and strong stuff. I mean, like, I was joking that in a couple months we're gonna turn on NXT and like Nick Gage is gonna be brutalizing Blake and Murphy with a power drill. I mean, it's so weird. It's so unpredictable these days.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, I'd like to see that.
It would actually make Blake and Murphy kind of interesting to me. Although I wouldn't blame them for not wanting to go through that.
That makes sense. But yeah, that's it's a good topic really because you know, when you think about it, the dynamic is really different now than it's ever been because there's really like been only WWE for so long as like the biggest place to go. But you know, after WCW folded and there was nothing, just WWE, it was kind of like a wrestling wasteland at that point, because there wasn't a lot of like huge indie promotions to fall back to.
Right,
ECW was
true.
Gone, and WCW was gone, and NXT was, I mean, NXT wasn't didn't exist, TNA didn't even exist. So it was the kind of thing where, you know, everybody was just like, we got no place to work. What are we going to do? And then, like, slowly since that time, WWE is still, like, the only, like, real major promotion. But now there's, like, a ton of small but bigger indie promotions. You know, like, you've got your Ring of Honor. You've got, you know, Pro Wrestling Guerrilla, Evolve, those kind of things. They're not huge, but they're, you know, people can go there and they want to go there. So it's the kind of thing where the landscape is a little bit different. It's like having one giant national promotion where, and suddenly they've managed to build up a territory system beneath that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's fascinating how it's developed. I mean, I've said this and I stand by it. I think there's never been a better time to be a wrestling fan. There's so much stuff out there that's so easy to follow right now. Nobody's had the kind of stuff that we have at our fingertips. I just kind of don't know where the future is going to take us.
It's interesting to think about, because not only did the indie promotions gotten bigger, it's gotten bigger internationally too, where like you've got people, you know, like from Europe and doing, there's like a bunch of smaller European promotions that have gotten bigger, and Japan, and you know, you in Mexico, actually, like you think about like Lucha Underground, stuff like that, like they pulled a bunch of guys from AAA. It's the kind of thing where, like, you know, previously you would never have seen that kind of stuff, but now, like, they've all kind of rose up a bit, so you've got a bigger pool of kind of bigger small fish, I guess, is the way to say it.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. And when I was going over my my list of indie people, I should have mentioned Leva Bates, who not only made a big appearance for NXT at a takeover in Brooklyn, but she also has her own T-shirt for sale in the NXT shop, which is bizarre. Even though she's still doing indie dates, it's a really weird time to be a wrestling fan. I think it's a great time to be a wrestling fan too.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely more stuff to watch now than any time I can remember, which is nice. I mean, it's good if you're a wrestling fan. So, I mean, I don't know how healthy it is overall for people getting paid and stuff, but you know, it's good for indie wrestlers too. If like you can exist as an indie wrestler as your job, like you don't have to, you know, hold a 9-to-5 and then indie wrestle also. Then
right.
It's probably a pretty good situation.
Yep, absolutely. Well, you know, I think that's all the time we have for this week. But you know, a little philosophical this time, and that's fine.
Yeah, that's kind of what happens sometimes. You get us two together, and we'll go way off topic and get a little philosophical. It's kind of just kind of what happens.
That's true. That's very true. All right. Well, you know, join us next week, and you can check us out online at closetofanxiety.tumblr.com. You can also find us on YouTube, which is presumably how you found this, or you can find us on Twitter. I'm at TJ Breen,
and I am at xcoremuffinx, which I've made a more concerted effort to check my Twitter. I posted stuff on Twitter recently. That's a rarity. So yeah, maybe if you talk to me on Twitter, I might talk back to you, but probably
do
still
it.
Your best bet is, the YouTube video, even though YouTube has suddenly stopped giving me notifications of when there's comments. So it might actually be faster to get to me on Twitter, because I might not notice comments.
Wow. There you go. There you go. Also, thanks to the person who tweeted us and wanted to see the awful t-shirts that we talked about last week, because then I posted the awful t-shirts on the Tumblr, and you can see for yourself some of the worst wrestling t-shirts. And if you find other bad wrestling t-shirts, we still want to know and want to see them.
Yeah, because the ones we found were all awful beyond belief, but if I'm sure there's more awful ones out there somewhere. If you can find them, please send them to us. We'll definitely talk about them.
All right. Well, thanks for listening, and tune in next week when hopefully no one will jump the barrier and try to make sex with a SHIELD member.
All right. See you guys next time.